A very, very warm welcome to yet another Kumekucha video. Information and analysis that is very difficult to find anywhere else. I recommend that you subscribe and you hit the bell button so that you receive notifications every time I have a new video. Karibu sana and enjoy.
Nikuulizwa ninaulizwa iko namna gani? Nikamwambia hapa. Naona hii kingangi hii. Ni kingangi ya kweli. Lakini muamue watu wetu. Muamue. Kwa sababu wakianza kueneza hiyo maneno ya propaganda kwamba kuna watu ambao hawaamini uongozi wa mheshimiwa Kalonzo Musyoka, sisi wengine tutamfuata. It is up to you, make up your minds. Yeah, but from what I have seen today, hiyo ni mambo ya magazeti. Na mnajua ni kina nani wana
wanatangatanga.
Tumetoka mbali na mheshimiwa Kalonzo, na aliwaambia lakini hakufafanua wakati walikuwa anaita yeye sijui nini. His vision, and it is actually pronounced now by His Excellency the President, is to see a united Kenya and the fight against corruption. Hiyo mumeelewa? Sasa hata juzi mimi nashangaa kuna conference ya kujadili jinsi ya kupigana na ufisadi, alafu yule mtu anajadiliwa ako hapo. Naona haya. Mwevage, mwaigwa. Mujipa? Todo, kwera wadide kwa eke. E maguru. Okay? Ukitaka kusaidiwa kusukuma punda ipande mlima, lazima usaidiwe ifike pale, alafu hapo inajipele. Mimi nimejionea. Na nyinyi wabunge, nyinyi, maanzo. My message, you must show us now by action. Yeah? Ama namna gani? Utuonyeshe kwa vitendo. Mwezi Mwandolo, mimi na wewe ni retired. But we are not tired. Ama mnaona kama tumechoka? Sisi tutatembea hii dunia. Na tutatembea na mheshimiwa Kalonzo. Yeah? Uhuru is going for his last and final term. Sijui huyo mwingine kama pia atakuwa kinganganyiro. Eh? Atujui. Atuwezi kusemea mtu. Ama namna gani? Lakini pia tuko na swali tutaenda tutauliza kwa mahakama. Na hiyo ni nasema na siogopi. Ikiwa wewe, the constitution says the president cannot run for more than 2 terms. Correct? It also says the deputy president cannot run for more than 2 terms as deputy president. Correct? But now they are saying he can run as president. Si wanasema hiyo? Sasa nauliza, kuna kitu inazuia Uhuru kuwa deputy?
It would seem that Murathe is just getting started. Many Kenyans thought that since he resigned from the Jubilee Party, this old man would lie low. But this particular speech that got national attention clearly tells us Murathe is just warming up. Now, there are tons of issues here. Yeah, I don't even know where to start. But let us start with where this meeting was. It was in Yatta, in a farm belonging to Kalonzo Musyoka. Those allied to Kalonzo Musyoka say that this particular farm was gifted to Kalonzo by retired President Daniel Arap Moi, yeah, in the KANU days. Those who are opposed to Kalonzo Musyoka say that actually he grabbed, yeah, this farm from the National Youth Service. Whichever version you want to believe, yeah, the bottom line is that Kalonzo Musyoka did not pay for this massive farm somewhere in Yatta. And by there in Yatta, people grow fruits. And although it is in Ukambani, people do serious farming there. Okay? Now, what was the reason for the meeting? Simply put, the Wiper leader has been under siege, yeah, in recent days. He's had a barrage of attacks from other politicians within Ukambani. Yeah, people jostling to be power brokers, yeah, within Ukambani. People like Alfred Mutua, the governor of Machakos, Charity Ngilu, the Kitui governor, and Professor Kivutha Kibwana, the Makueni governor. A new emerging crop of Kamba leaders who are focused on development rather than on patronage politics, yeah, which is how Kalonzo Musyoka plays his politics. Now, the purpose of this meeting was for Kalonzo to show his opponents that he has got support, yeah, from the powerful in the country, directly from President Uhuru Kenyatta. If you can't get the president there to show his support for Kalonzo Musyoka, yeah, why not get his chief advisor, his most visible, most powerful advisor, David Murathe? So Kalonzo Musyoka gathered his MCAs and invited Murathe all the way to Yatta. And as you have heard very clearly in the clip, Murathe has promised to support Kalonzo Musyoka. In case you missed it, he said, tutatembea na mheshimiwa Kalonzo Musyoka. Yeah, we'll walk together. We'll travel countrywide, yeah, promoting a certain agenda. Now, this is where things start getting very confusing. I'll tell you why. Murathe's agenda is very clear. Yeah, Murathe's agenda is anti-DP William Ruto, to stop the deputy president from ever becoming president of Kenya. That's his mission. That's his agenda. Now, the agenda of Kalonzo Musyoka is to become president of Kenya. Not deputy, not prime minister, not anything else, but president of the Republic of Kenya. Period. That's Kalonzo's agenda. Now, we also know that Kalonzo is cooperating very closely with Deputy President William Ruto. And let me give you the most recent example. The election of Embakasi South Member of Parliament, Julius Mawathe, who is a Wiper member, yeah, was nullified by the highest court in the land. So what that means is that watu warudi kwa debe, yeah, a by-election, which is slated for April 5th. Now, there's a complication here, because the man who has been fighting, yeah, tooth and nail since the elections in August 2017 to have this election overturned is an ODM man. Yeah, a man called Ishad Sumra. Now, Sumra is the immediate former member of parliament for Embakasi South. And I'm sure we're all aware that filing a petition is not cheap. It costs millions, double-digit millions. So after Bwana Sumra has fought so hard and finally managed to get the Embakasi South election of the current member of parliament overturned, the Wiper party have come up with an idea, yeah, a rather selfish idea. They have said, since we're in the handshake era, yeah, in the spirit of the handshake, we want Bwana Sumra to step down, yeah, withdraw from the race, and allow, yeah, Bwana Julius Mawathe to easily retake his seat. Now, the argument that Wiper have is that they have no other seat in Nairobi. Yeah, ODM has several. And so, in the spirit of cooperation of the handshake, and in the spirit of NASA, yeah, the NASA coalition, the ODM party must abandon what was agreed on going into the election, which was that the coalition was going to support one presidential candidate. But as far as the other seats are concerned, MCAs, MPs, etc., etc., member parties of NASA were free to vie anywhere, even against their own NASA people, or rather against NASA sister political parties. And so what Kalonzo Musyoka and the Wiper Party are saying is that let's forget all that. Sumra should just step down, withdraw from the race, and allow Julius Mawathe to sail through. Because even the Jubilee Party is not presenting a candidate for Embakasi South. It's not sponsoring any candidate. However, the faction within Jubilee Party that is allied to Deputy President William Samoei Ruto have pledged full support for Bwana Julius Mawathe, which is hardly surprising, because the DP Ruto camp and Raila Odinga, those are very serious arch rivals. So the complication is here. DP William Samoei Ruto is supporting the Wiper Party for the Embakasi South by-election. However, we have all just viewed a clip, a Wiper function, where Mawathe is pushing his anti-DP Ruto campaign and agenda, and is being cheered on by Wiper MCAs. And you've heard very clearly those MCAs are very enthusiastically against DP William Ruto. Ay, kuchanganyikiwa nayo. Loose translation, how about confusion at its height? Actually, there's no confusion. This is politics. And as I said in a recent video, in politics, there are no permanent friends and there are no permanent enemies. And in any case, Wiper has been cooperating with DP William Ruto for a very long time. Where their mutual interests concerned, the two will come together before you can say the word partnership. However, I can tell you one thing for free. Mawathe is not going to go around the country with Kalonzo Musyoka. That will never happen. How do I know that? It's very simple. This is politics. And there's no, absolutely no mutual interest between Kalonzo Musyoka and David Mawathe. In other words, if I can put it in Kenyan language, wana enjoy Kalonzo. That's the truth. And this is not the first time it has happened. Let me just take you back to 2013. As Mwai Kibaki was leaving office, as president of Kenya, Kalonzo Musyoka must have reminded him of their deal. What deal was that? When Mwai Kibaki was in serious problems after the 2007 elections, ill-fated elections, Kalonzo Musyoka controversially stepped in and helped prop up the then very shaky Mwai Kibaki government. And he accepted an appointment as vice president, which angered a lot of Kenyans. And the deal clearly was, I'm sticking with you. When the time comes, you must stick with me. But then at the tail end of Mwai Kibaki's presidency, Kalonzo Musyoka discovered that Mwai Kibaki was not rooting for him. Instead, he was rooting for another man called Musalia Mudavadi. But Kalonzo did not give up. He kept on putting pressure on Mwai Kibaki to be a gentleman and honor his deal. And so finally, when Mwai Kibaki blessed the William Ruto Uhuru Kenyatta team, the then president instructed the duo to work with Kalonzo, so that at least Kalonzo would be in the next government. But those of you who follow Kenyan politics closely will remember that Uhuru Kenyatta was quoted. This was revealed in a speech, but actually it was a private conversation. But we were told what had happened. Uhuru Kenyatta at the time told Kalonzo, I'm afraid we cannot work with you. Now, this took place during a late night meeting at Kalonzo Musyoka's residence. Yeah, present at that meeting were Uhuru Kenyatta, William Ruto, and billionaire Jimmy Wanjigi. Now, when Kalonzo realized that despite everything he had done for the Kibaki government, he was going to be pushed out yet again, he lost it. And he put down all his diplomacy credentials. And he said things that hurt William Ruto's feelings very much. Kalonzo Musyoka said, "When you guys come back from the prison term at The Hague," because there's no way the international community can accept for us to elect people who are already indicted for very serious criminal offenses at The Hague to vie for the presidency of Kenya. There's no way. So after you guys come back from The Hague, etc., etc., I think he meant that he will organize a soft landing for them back into Kenyan politics. And after he has served as president, Kalonzo Musyoka, that is, he would root for them to take over the presidency after he has finished his terms as president of Kenya. What Kalonzo was insinuating was that whatever jail terms Uhuru and Ruto would get at The Hague would not exceed 10 years. I'm telling you politics. So you know what happened? At the very last minute, Kalonzo Musyoka had to change, had to shift camps. And he ended up as running mate to Raila Odinga in those 2013 elections. Maybe the question to ask now is, why does Kalonzo Musyoka always find himself in this situation? Well, the answer is very simple. He has no political clout. In other words, he insists on sitting on the high table when he doesn't belong there. Because politics is brutal. Yeah, when you want to sit at the high table, the first question you'll be asked is, what do you have? What do you have to offer? Put what you have to offer on the table. And to be fair to Kalonzo, let's give other examples. So a man like Musalia Mudavadi comes to the high table. He's asked, what do you have to offer? He says the Maragoli vote, about half of the Luhya vote. Then he's asked, what about the rest of the country? He starts scratching his head. Then a man like Moses Wetangula also insists on sitting at the high table. So he's asked, what do you have? He says, I have the Bukusu vote. And he's asked, what else? He starts scratching his head. Then Kalonzo Musyoka comes to the table. He says, I have the Kamba vote. And the Kambas are a large tribe. So he's asked, how many votes are we talking about? And he starts scratching his head. And somebody goes into a computer and punches at the keys and says, about 2 million votes. Mr. Musyoka, is there anything else you can offer? Nothing. And then a man called Raila Odinga, whom people say on this channel, I'm a sycophant of Raila Odinga, which of course is rubbish. I'm just talking reality, cold facts. So Raila is asked, what do you have to offer? But even before he can answer, somebody punches again the keys of that laptop, and they say, Bwana Odinga, sit down. You say, welcome to the high table. Let's discuss. Let's do business. Yes, it's reality. Politics, at the end of the day, is a game of numbers. If you don't have the numbers, then really, what are we discussing? Now, sadly for Kenyans, Bwana Kalonzo Musyoka works very closely with Musalia Mudavadi and Moses Wetangula. But even if you take their combined number of votes together, they're not large enough to make a dent in any presidential election in Kenya. Very sad, but very true. So what is very sad about this situation is that Raila Odinga shakes hands with Uhuru Kenyatta, and suddenly there's no opposition in Kenya. There's nobody else with enough clout to be a serious opposition in Kenya. You know, let me illustrate this further. There was a very interesting discussion talk show on television where Jeff Koinange hosted Tony Gashoka, and they were discussing about the political situation in the country. I believe this was before the handshake, but I could be wrong. And Jeff Koinange kept on asking Bwana Gachoka time and again, what about Wetangula? What about Musalia Mudavadi? And Bwana Gachoka just kept on waving his hands and ignoring that question. And I think at one point, Bwana Gachoka said, those are non-entities. Yeah, you know, who are you talking about? Now, maybe some of you will say Bwana Gachoka was being unkind. Yeah, very arrogant. However, actually, he was just speaking nothing but the truth. Because there's a huge difference between being known by very many Kenyans, being known all over Kenya, and having enough political numbers, for you to sit at the high table. There's a very huge difference. And for you to feature in a serious discussion about the future of Kenyan politics. And there's a very simple test. Just go to Uhuru Park and call for a meeting. How many people will turn up? And that is why when Kalonzo Musyoka was under siege, from these other Ukambani leaders, he did not dare call for a public rally. Instead, he invited MCAs to his farm in Yatta. It's very simple. If a man like Raila Odinga wakes up in the morning, just this morning, and goes to Uhuru Park, and just says, I'm calling for a meeting of all Kenyans, you've not even given people advance warning, you're going to be shocked. There'll be suddenly a crowd control problem. Now, with all due respect to a very great Kenyan, whom I have a lot of respect for, a man called Miguna Miguna, but let us just be very realistic, What if Miguna Miguna were to go to Uhuru Park and even give people 1 week's notice for a political meeting? How many people would turn up? Well, I have a feeling the numbers would be larger than those of Kalonzo Musyoka, larger than those of Musalia Mudavadi, and larger than those of Weta, or Moses Wetangula. But I don't think there would be a crowd control problem. No way. And I'm persuaded that because of the recent book he has released, which fires a lot of barbs at Raila Odinga, that meeting may have a problem of numbers. Maybe 2-3 months ago, he would have attracted an impressive crowd. But today, after the release of that book, and that just speaks to the clout that Raila Odinga wields in the country. You may hate him. You may hate him so much you can't stand him. You may say very nasty things about him. However, you call your meeting and let him call his. Let the people decide. Let the people decide how stupid or how bad or how nasty Raila Odinga is. Let the people decide. Folks, in politics, you have to be realistic. You must be realistic. Otherwise, you could very easily end up being a laughing stock, which, by the way, is very easy in politics. But back to Murathe. In my opinion, Murathe was just having fun in Yatta. Although as he was having fun, he let loose, he released some sensitive information here and there. At one point, he made a remark and he said, this other man, of course he was referring to the deputy president, we don't even know if he'll be in the ballot. And then he realized he had given too much information. So he suddenly recovered and he said, we can't make a decision for him, blah, 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 blah. But I read between the lines about Murathe's strategy and his team. Clearly, their strategy is the deputy president should not be on the ballot in 2022. That's what they want to ensure. And that should be very clear. There's no doubt about the intention of Bwana Murathe and his team. No doubts whatsoever, according to me. And also according to you, if you listened and watched carefully. Now, this meeting, there's something which Murathe said, which the press picked up and made huge headlines out of. He said, there's nothing stopping President Uhuru Kenyatta from vying again. For deputy president. Now, I'm sure many Kenyans missed something here. Because DP Ruto supporters can come out and say, fine, let him run as deputy as long as our man is president, there's no problem. Yeah, we have to follow the constitution. Now, in my view, that is an extremely dangerous loophole in our constitution that should be sealed. It is extremely dangerous for a former president to vie and actually succeed in being the deputy president. Why? Okay, let me start with a practical example. When Rwanda was recovering from the mess, from the mess of the bloodbath that took place there, very unfortunately, in the new government that was formed immediately after, Paul Kagame was not the president. No, he wasn't. He was the vice president. But I can bet you to date, nobody remembers who the president was then. In fact, very few people remember that he was actually the vice president and not the president. Why? Because he wielded all the power and all the clout. He controlled the defense forces. He controlled everything. He wielded all the power. The president was just a figurehead. Now, constitution or no constitution, when somebody as powerful as a president of a country, goes into the next elections and becomes the deputy president, you can be sure that deputy president will be more powerful than the president, constitution or no constitution. Because the information he has, the people who are loyal to him, when he was president, and he's still there, and those people are still there, and now he's deputy, that will not be a deputy president. That will in fact be the president. The constitutional president will have no room to breathe. And to make matters worse, when you remove him from being president, or rather when he comes out from being president and becomes a deputy president, he has a lot more time on his hands to play mischief. So that if push comes to shove, all that deputy president needs to do is to blackmail the president. That is the reality of politics. I just want you to get the full impact of that Murathe threat. Because it's a threat. Believe it or not. And there's another way of looking at it, which I believe is the way most people looked at it. Supposing in the next election, because the constitution does not bar him, President Uhuru Kenyatta decides to run as deputy president and running mate to say Moses Wetangula, let's take the week of the candidates. He decides to run as deputy president to Moses Wetangula. What do you think would happen? Or he runs as deputy to Ali Hassan Joho. Ali Hassan Joho president, Uhuru Kenyatta deputy president. And of course, Joho is a Raila man, to the hilt. And of course, Raila would support such a such a team. That would be a winning team. Now, we've discussed a lot of things, but let's sum it up. I think Bwana David Murathe, in my view, is just warming up. He's just getting started. And we should expect a lot more drama from this man. And you can see he's really enjoying himself, because he has got nothing to stop him from saying whatever he wants to say. Nobody can turn around and say, is this what Jubilee are saying? Is this the policy of Jubilee? Nobody. Even if he still advises the president, nobody can pin down Murathe or link his comments to the presidency. Because the work of advising anybody is confidential. It's done in secret. It's not a public thing. So there's nothing wrong with advising the president in the morning and then in the afternoon, you're out playing politics. Even if the president was not aware of what you're doing, you'd not be worried. You'd have absolutely no reason to get worried. You just talk, whatever you want to talk. However, I have to say that if you think Murathe is working alone, you're naive, very naive. And my apologies for insulting you. But let us just speak the truth and let us remain realistic. Until next time, this is Chris Kumekucha.